So good morning, everybody. Today and welcome. Sorry, so welcome again for these seminars from the Institute of Astronomía de Andalucía here in Granada, in Spain. And today we will have the talk by Dr. Miguel Pereira Santaella from CAB, Centro de Astrobiología in Madrid, Spain, and he will talk about the PUMA project. Miguel will be properly introduced by our colleague Sara Casoli. Sara, please.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the talk. I'm really excited to have the opportunity to introduce Miguel. So sorry if my Italian accent is stronger than usually. I met Miguel in 2011 at the beginning of my PhD, and I shared the office with him twice and in different stages of his career as a PhD, as a postdoc. So Miguel, in academia, you are more experienced than me, but I can say that I see you growing up and it was a pleasure and I learned a lot from you. Miguel got his PhD from Universidad Autónoma de Madrid in 2012. Now he holds an Atracción de Talento Comunidad de Madrid Advanced Grant at the Centro de Astrobiología in CSIC, a Center of Excellencia María de Maezu. He obtained this fellowship after three postdocs in different countries, first Rome, deeply involved in SPICA and coordinating the science working group about the role of feedback in galaxy evolution. Second, Madrid, where he acquired experience in working with ALMA data. And third, Oxford, with working with a special emphasis to future capabilities, such as 30-meter telescope ELT. Indeed, he is a project scientist of Harmony Instrument and is the main developer of the science simulator HSIM that is already available on GitHub. Summarizing this postdoc stage of your career in three words: infrared, millimeter, and optical. But this is not the end of the story. In the past, Miguel worked with X-ray examined Newton data, and he also applied radiative transfers code, such as Cloudy and Radex, to model observation. A wide expertise, a lot of paper, 15 papers as the first author, but many more, and also a long journey filled with nice moments and memories. He also a very good friend of mine. And finally, a quick reminder for IAA people. Miguel is here today and tomorrow. Do not miss the opportunity to share, present, and discuss science with him. That's all. Miguel, the floor is yours.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Sarah, for the introduction. And thank you, the organizer, for giving me this opportunity to present this talk. So let me share the screen. So I think now you should be able to see the screen.
Perfect, yes.
Okay, so I will start. So I want to talk about the interaction and mergers of galaxies and feedback and what we can learn about this process by observing local ULIRGs with ALMA. And in particular, I will describe the PUMA project. So this is the outline of the talk. So I will present first a short introduction describing mergers, LIRGs, and ULIRGs. Then I will describe the PUMA project and the ALMA observations mainly. And then I will just explain two of the results we have obtained so far. And I will also briefly explain some of the future plans that we have. So, well, why galaxy mergers are important. So basically, in the cosmological model, in the hierarchical galaxy formation model, mergers are the main process that by which massive galaxies build up their stellar mass. We have here some simulation for the New Horizon collaboration, and we see that galaxies are continually having this kind of interaction or minor mergers. So they increase their stellar mass, not only by accreting the stars from the other galaxy that they merge, but also because these interactions can trigger star formation and AGN, and they can form a significant fraction of the stellar mass. In this particular example, we have the final part of this animation, an interaction with this one with a similar mass star galaxy, and we see that at that moment, this galaxy goes from about 40 solar masses per year to almost 200. So this is one of the effects of these interactions. And also it's important to mention here that this AGN and star formation, they seem to be some kind of self-regulate by some feedback processes that I will discuss later. And another important consequence of these mergers are that it's one of the possible mechanisms that are proposed to explain this transition from spiral galaxies to passive galaxies like ellipticals or SCO. So as we saw in the animation, mergers were common at high redshift. This is a merger of Serra redshift 2, but as we see, these are faint objects, and also the angular sizes are relatively small. So if we want to make a detailed study of the effects of mergers, we need to observe local mergers where we have a much higher spatial resolution, but also in terms of sensitivity, they are much closer. So the observed flux is much higher. So we are able to detect with a higher signal to noise a larger number of tracers. I will explain briefly how are the local gas-rich mergers that are basically local LIRGs and ULIRGs. LIRGs and ULIRGs is just a definition based on the infrared luminosity. So LIRGs are galaxies with luminosities between 10 to the 11 and 10 to the 12 solar luminosities, and ULIRGs are between 10 to the 12 and 10 to the 13. This means that these galaxies are 10 to 100 times more luminous like a normal spiral. And then, since this classification is just based on luminosity, there is no like a physical reason to say that 10 to the 11 means something. So what is found is that there's some threshold about 10 to 11.5 solar luminosities, where above that threshold, the great majority of the galaxies are interactions. And this is what we are going to discuss today. And this is in this plot, we have the redshift evolution of this class of galaxies. So in the local universe, the number of galaxies with the luminosities is relatively low. But when we go to higher redshift, we see that the contribution to the total luminosity is much higher. And in particular, ULIRGs at high redshift that are possibly these gas-rich mergers that may have this important role in the evolution of galaxies. Then another important point is how this infrared luminosity is produced. So LIRGs and ULIRGs are systems that are extremely obscure, so they have a large amount of dust. Typical extinctions are like AB larger than 10 to 50 magnitudes or even higher. So that means that the optical diagnostics is not possible to apply them to these systems. And we need to go to wavelengths where the extinction effects are reduced. For example, based on mid-infrared observations, what is found is that the star formation dominates the luminosity of these galaxies, but the AGN contribution is increased. And this is basically because the dust absorbs all the emission from star formation and AGN, and then this is re-emitted in the infrared. But as we see later, maybe even the mid-infrared is not enough to see the true nature of what is powering these systems. So then this is to put in context what are LIRGs and ULIRGs compared to main sequence stars. So as I said before, the LIRG and ULIRG definition is based on the luminosity. If this luminosity is produced by star formation, we can transform different luminosity into star formation rate. And in this plot, what I have is this is a sample of LIRGs that if we see where they were located in this diagram, star formation stellar mass, at 100 megagiras ago, these galaxies were like normal main sequence stars. But something happened, an interaction basically, that increases their star formation rate, their infrared luminosity, and they become LIRGs. So This means that we are witnessing this transformation, or this in this diagram is what I try to say to show is this transformation from a main sequence star that has a starburst, so it becomes a leak in some cases, depending, for example, on the relative mass, major, minor mergers, the fraction of gas, sometimes they become ULIRGs. And we want to understand what happens after these galaxies stop the star formation, because they can reform a disk and return to the main sequence, but in some cases, they can become a passive galaxy. And in particular, this path on this diagram, star formation star mass, depends on several factors. As I said before, the relative mass, the gas fraction, and in this talk, I will focus on this feedback and gas outflows and the role of the AGN star formation. And now, okay, so I will present the PUMA project. PUMA stands for Physical Fuelers with MUSE and ALMA. And this is the, well, most of the people that is contributing to this project, mainly the people working on the ALMA part. And the PUMA sample is a sample of 25 local ULIRGs, and that we selected to have half of the sample to be interacting systems and the other half to be mergers. By interacting, I mean systems with nuclear separation larger than 1 kiloparsecs. Merger are systems where we are not able to resolve the two nuclei. Then we also selected these galaxies to have half of the interacting system to be star formation dominated, the other half AGN, and we did the same for the mergers, to have half mergers dominated by star formation and the other half by AGN. And the final criterion was to try to cover the infrared luminosity range from 10 to the 12 to 10 to the 12.7. The data we have for these galaxies, we have the ALMA observation with ALMA of the CO2-1 transition observed at a resolution of 500 parsecs. That this is between 0.1 to 0.3 arc seconds. And this is a tracer of cold molecular gas. And then we also obtain MUSE optical IFS data with adaptive optics, which has a resolution about 0.5 arc seconds. And in addition to the ALMA and MUSE, all these galaxies also have a Spitzer infrared spectroscopy, and many of them have also HST, Herschel, radio, and X-ray information. The main goals of this project are, the first one is to study the incidence of the outflows in all their phases, atomic and molecular, depending on the interaction phase, the nuclear activity, and also the luminosity. And then establish what are the driving mechanism of the outflows, either starbursts or AGN, and also characterize the feedback effects on the host galaxy. So now I will present some of the results we have obtained so far. So I will start with spatially resolved outflows in ULIRGs. So in this diagram, I try to explain what happened when you have a star formation or AGN in a galaxy. These two processes inject energy, momentum, and material into the ISM. And as a consequence, the turbulence of the ISM is increased, also the heating. And another consequence of this injection of energy, momentum, and material is the presence of massive outflows. And as a consequence of this effect on the ISM, this produces some feedback, and in the end, this is some kind of self-regulation of the star formation and AGN. So we focus on these massive outflows as a proof of these feedback effects, and these are some general properties of these outflows. So these are detected to have velocities higher to 100 km per second, up to 1,000 or even more. And this compared to the escape velocity of a giant molecular cloud, that is 2 to 20. So this is gas that is escaping the gravitational potential of these GNCs. Then another point is that they have a different geometry. We have, in some cases, these outflows are perpendicular to the disk of the galaxy. For example, in this, this is M82, so this is a starburst, and we see all these, this is H alpha, so we see all these ionized gas above and below of the disk. And in other cases, for example, in AGMs, we have like a random orientation, because basically this depends on the orientation of the jets and how it intersects the disk of the galaxy, that in principle is more random than that we have for a starburst. The more properties about these outflows is that they are multi-phase. So they have ionized phase that is typically traced in the optical with H-alpha, the oxygen 3 lines, and also the nitrogen 2. They also have an atomic neutral phase that is traced with the sodium absorption on, and also with the 21 centimeter H1 line. And these outflows also have a molecular phase. This molecular phase is detected at several temperatures. We have the hot phase with temperatures higher than 1000 K that is detected with the near infrared H2 lines. But we also have a cold phase that is colder than 100 K more or less, that is traced by the CO and OH or HCN transition. And this cold phase is the one that seems to dominate the outflow mass and therefore the outflow momentum and energy. There are many studies of outflows in ULIRGs at all these phases, ionized, atomic, and molecular. But we focus on the molecular phase, that is the one that dominates the mass. One of the problems of this, of most of these observations so far, is that they do not spatially resolve the outflows. So they is not straightforward to measure the extent and the orientation of these outflows. One of the key parameters of these outflows is the outflow rate. And to calculate this outflow rate, we can use this equation that depends on the outflow mass, that is basically the flux of the outflow, the velocity of the outflow, but also we have here the size of the radius of this outflow. This is one not resolved observation of an outflow. So we see we have the narrow line, this, the curve of the line that is produced by the system, the disk emission of this galaxy. And also it has these wings, which you can use to measure the mass and the velocity of the outflow. But then when you want to measure the radius, then it's very difficult because the resolution is like 3 kiloparsecs, but the sizes are typically smaller. So to properly measure these, the sizes and also the orientation of these outflows, we propose a program with ALMA some time ago in cycle 3 and 4 to observe three ULIRGs, interacting ULIRGs with 6 nuclei at high spatial resolution, like 500 parsecs, for which we already knew that they had a hot outflow, so the hot molecular phase of the outflow was already detected based on near infrared observations with synchrony. So we observed, obtained this data. This is the CO emission, and this is the continuum emission. And what is interesting here is to measure the kinematics of the molecular gas. So based on, so this is the integrated emission of the CO221 line for one of the galaxies that we observed. This is the moment one, this is the velocity of the gas. And to study the velocity of the, or for the distribution, the spatial distribution of the high velocity gas, what we did is to measure the center position of the emission at each velocity channel, because we have, with ALMA, we have high spectral resolution. So we have about 10 kilometers per second channels. And what we found is that the low velocity gas is aligned along this axis. So this is compatible with the major kinematic major axis. So it's basically the rotation of a disk. But then when we measure the position of the high velocity gas, we see that the resistant gas is located in this case to the north, and the blue shifted high velocity gas is to the south, and this is more or less perpendicular to the kinematic axis of the disk. And basically this is compatible with an outflow being perpendicular to the disk. And I put this here as an example, as I mentioned too, that this observation that we have for this unit is equivalent to this one. So we repeated this for all the systems that we observed. And this is what we found. So for three cases, we find that they are the high velocity gas is perpendicular to the kinematic axis of the disk, which is compatible with this kind of geometry of a perpendicular outflow. In one case, we find an angle that is not 90 degrees. So this could be an outflow that is in the plane of the galaxy, that is compatible with the outflow that you would expect from an AGN. And also in some cases, it's not possible to determine the orientation of this outflow. So this is a summary of the result of this pilot study. So we detected outflows in six of them. So 80% of the sample, we were able to measure the outflow rate, but also to determine the sizes and the geometry. As I said, three of them seem to be perpendicular to the plane. One, it could be an in-plane outflow that is possibly related to an AGN in that nucleus. And one is not clear. Then we find sizes that are between 0.31 kiloparsec, the effective size, and velocities between 400, 500, or up to 900 kilometers per second. These numbers imply outflow rates between 10, 12, and 400 solar masses per year. That is comparable to the star formation rate of the system. So these outflows could have or have a relevant impact on the evolution of these galaxies, and they are using the same amount of mass, let's say, of the star formation is that is producing in these galaxies. Then another important result from this work is that since we can measure the sizes and the velocities, we can determine the fraction of the gas that can escape the gravitational gravity potential of the galaxy. And we find that only between 15-30% of the gas will escape the galaxy, and most of the gas will return to the disk in just 5 to 10 megayears. So this gas that we see now in the outflow will be available again to form stars in 3 years. And then these are the results from the pilot study, but we are doing the analysis for the whole sample. And Isabella Lamperti, who's a postdoc who is working with me in this project, will soon submit the paper with the analysis for the complete sample. Something that we need to take into account is that this equation to calculate this outflow rate also depends on the outflow dynamics and the CO conversion factor. I will now discuss a bit about how is the evolution of the molecular gas in the outflow based on the result that we obtained. So basically we find that the sizes of these outflows are quite similar between 0.3 and 1 kiloparsecs. So the variation of this size is much smaller than the factor of 30 that we have in the mass outflow rate. And this implies, since the velocities are also similar, that for all the systems, the dynamical times of this ratio is relatively small, 3 megayears. And also another result that we know is that these outflows are multi-phase. So we can ask this question. So why we find all the outflows with similar sizes is because maybe the molecular gas does not survive in the outflow, or the molecular gas do not form efficiently in the outflow, or maybe it's too diffuse to be detected, or it's clumpy, or maybe there's a transition from molecular to atomic at this distance. But so to study this, we have this for the ULIRGs. This is 500 parsec resolution. And with this data, it's not obvious to resolve the clumpy structure of the outflow. So in this case, we need to study this evolution, we need to go to high resolution data. In this case, this is a leak for which we have a 70 parsec resolution ALMA observation. In particular, this leak is an isolated spiral that is star formation dominated, but it contains a cone, that is this compact obscure nucleus. which has extremely high molecular gas density and also infrared luminosity that is similar to what we find on ULIRGs. So this is like a scaled down version of the nucleus of ULIRG, even if this is an isolated spiral. So these are some of the properties of this galaxy. As you can see here, it's a bar, actually it's a double bar spiral that is isolated. The outflow rate is about 5 solar masses per year, but the nucleus, and this is the relevant point here, has an extremely high obscuration that is similar to what is found in ULIRGs. The star formation rate in this nucleus is also quite high, 15 solar masses per year. And this nucleus, compact nucleus, only 200 parsec, and this high star formation rate and H density implies that these values, this sigma H2, this surface density of H2 and star formation rate, are similar to ULIRGs. And this can be explained because in this galaxy, there is a massive inflow of about 20 solar masses per year that is piling up all the gas in this central part. So for this galaxy, we obtain ALMA CO data at this resolution, 70 parsecs of these lines, the CO 120, 21, 423, and 625, just to study the not only the kinematic, but also the physical condition of the gas in the outflow. So based on the kinematics of this outflow, what we find, well, as I said before, we are able to resolve the outflow in different clumps. And one of the results is that the clumps are less massive when we increase the distance from the nucleus. And another result is that the velocity of these clumps is relatively constant. So this has, so to explain these two observations, we need, for example, to explain that the clump mass decreases with the distance is maybe because there is some molecular, the expansion of the molecular gas. This is one possibility to explain this. Then the constant velocity implies that the gas is being accelerated. And actually what we measure is that at distances less than 500 parsecs, we find like a point of 1 kilometer per second per parsec acceleration. And beyond this distance, the gas in the outflow seems to have a maximum velocity that is relatively constant. But this, so finding this relatively constant also implies that the gas is being accelerated because we need to remember that this gas is affected by the gravitational attraction from the galaxy. And this is what is represented in this diagram here. So if we model the gravitational attraction potential from this galaxy, we can determine that if we have gas with this velocity, this 600 kilometers per second, that is more or less the maximum velocity that we detect the gas at this distance. This gas, if it just evolves due to gravity effects, then its velocity will decrease with distance. And this red part is like the forbidden region for the gas in the outflow based on this pure gravity evolution. But instead, what we find is that when we go far from the center of the galaxy, we actually find gas at this forbidden region. So that means that the gas to reach this location, distance from the center, is being accelerated. So how to explain this acceleration of the gas? So one option is that it's through radiation pressure. But one problem is that when we go at this distance, the gravity is much stronger than the radiation pressure. So in the central part, there can be large radiation pressure, but at this distance, the radiation is not enough to sustain the observed velocities. So one alternative that we propose in this paper to explain the observation is that, as we know, outflows are multi-phase. So they have a high velocity ionized hot gas that is around the molecular gas. So this is represented here. So we have this X-ray emitting gas with some clumps of molecular gas embedded on it. So if we assume that the run pressure due to this high velocity ionized gas as well as the evaporation of the clouds, the expansion of the molecular gas in these clouds. So with these two physical processes, we can explain that the outflow velocity is relatively constant with distance, and also that the size of the outflow is limited independently on the outflow rate. Then another result that we obtain from this analysis are on the physical condition of the gas that is in the outflow. So this is the observations of the four CO transitions. And what we find is that the outflow is evident in the CO2-1 line, also in the 1-0. But then in the higher excitation transition, the 4-3 and 6-5, the outflow is not detected. And this is maybe more clear in this diagram, but we see that this blue high velocity wind is clearly detected in these two lines, the 1-0 and the 2-1. But then when we go to the 4-3, we detect the core of the line. This is the underlying disk emission in this galaxy that is similar to what we have in the 1-0 and the 2-1. But then we do not detect the high velocity gas in this transition. We can do this to obtain the CO spectrum light energy distribution. So this is the CO emission as a function of the excitation of the CO line. And we find that for the nucleus, that is the region launching the outflow, the excitation is much higher. We detect the 4-3 line and also 6-5. But when we go to the outflow, basically we have some robust measurement of these upper limits that are much lower than the values that are in the nucleus. And we only detect outflow in this low excitation transition. And this suggests that the physical condition of the gas that is in the disk also in the nucleus are quite different from the conditions of the gas that we have in the outflow. We did a non-LTE analysis of these sleds. And these are the main results that we obtained. So we find that the clouds in the outflow are colder. We find temperature around 10K, that is lower than the gas that is in the nucleus. These clouds are also smaller, with sizes of just 0.2 parsecs compared to the 5 mean size that we find in the nucleus. We also find that these clouds are not bound by gravity, so this partially supports that they are affected by these round pressure effects. And finally, what is relevant to calculate the star formation, the outflow rate, is this XCO conversion factor. So it's the factor that transforms the CO emission into a molecular mass. So we are not able to determine it basically because we have a large uncertainty on the density of the gas, but it could be compatible with the conversion factor of ULIRGs. So now, another result that we have to explain the luminosity of the systems that could be either extreme star formation or an AGN. As I said before, for these ULIRGs in the ALMA data, we have the CO2-1, but we also have the continuum, the 220 more or less continuum, 220 gigahertz. So this is the SED of a galaxy, I think it's M82. So with ALMA, we are observing this part of the SED. And for this galaxy, we see that this is the emission from dust. In ULIRGs, this dust is tracing the obscure star formation. So if we assume that there is a star formation law, like a chemical Smith law, that relates the star formation rate that could be traced by the infraluminosity with the molecular gas mass that is traced by the CO, we in principle expect to find similar morphologies for the continuum, for the 220 continuum, and for the CO emission. But instead, what we find is that the emission from the continuum and the CO are very different. We find that the continuum is more compact in all ULIRGs. We can model this continuum emission, and actually we find that there is an unresolved source that is contributing more than 50% of the flux. For this galaxy, the upper limit on the radius is just 40 parsecs, and there is an extended source contributing the other more or less half of the flux. that this is 400 passive, but still is more compact than the emission that we see in CO. So we did this for all the galaxies, and we find that many galaxies have an unresolved continuum source with sizes less than 60 parsecs, a median value of 100 parsecs. And we find that CO sizes that are typically 60 is the most extreme case, but the sizes could be up to 700 parsecs, a median of the 600 parsecs, which is three times larger than the size that we see in the continuum. So all basically all the units have CO2-1 molecular gas sizes larger than the sizes that we have from the continuum. So how to explain this? Because if this continuum is tracing the star formation, they should have a similar size and morphology compared to the cold molecular gas, the CO2-1. So to investigate some possible systematic effects, we model the SED of these ULIRGs using the Herschel data and also the Spitzer data. And in most of cases, we find that the ALMA flux is within less than a factor of two of the prediction of this extrapolation of this black body or gray body based on the Herschel or the infrared SED. Then some possible systematic effects are that, well, ALMA is an interferometer, so it's possible that some of the flux is filtered. But in principle, the data has is sensible to scales larger than 4 kiloparsecs, while the sizes of the continuum are between 60 and 600 parsecs. So in principle, we should have the sensitivity to detect these possible extended sizes. Then we also investigated is a signal-to-noise problem, but we can also constrain the contribution of this diffuse emission to be less than 8% of the flux. Then at this wavelength or this frequency, we also have a possible important contribution from free-free emission and synchrotron emission, but we are able also to constrain this free-free contribution to be, this is, we only have for this value an upper limit that is less than 50%, and also from the synchrotron emission that we estimate based on the radio observation that typically contributes less than 20%. So basically what we have here is that with ALMA, the continuum that we observe is dominated by the dust emission, this extrapolation of the infrared SED. So basically this continuum traces the size of the infrared emission of these ULIRGs. Since we can measure the infrared size, we can determine the surface density of the infrared luminosity, that if we assume that this is produced by star formation, we can translate this infrared luminosity to star formation. And we also have the H2 surface density based on the CO emission. And we compare this with local spiral and starburst galaxy, and we see that ULIRGs have more extreme infrared surface densities than local spiral and starburst for the amount of molecular gas they contain. So this is the detail of this relation. So basically we find depletion times, the ratio between the two quantities, less than 10 megagiga, or even in many cases less than 1 megagiga, that is compared to a normal galaxy, that is 100 megagiga, 1 megagiga. And we also have another result here, that this yellow orange line is the Eddington limit. So anything above this line, the radiation pressure is stronger than the gravity. So what we find here is that we have systems with the extreme infrared luminosities, much more extreme than in local systems, that many of them are above the Eddington limit. And also we find that for a typical IMF, these luminosities for this amount of gas imply efficiencies higher than 100%. So one possibility is that in the nuclei of these galaxies, the IMF is top heavy. So for each unit of molecular gas, we are able to produce higher luminosities. But in any case, we find that it is not possible to explain by standard star formation the observed infrared or this the observed molecular gas and infrared luminosities in this system. Another option is that these galaxies may host an AGN, an obscure AGN. As I said, we selected the sample to have both AGN dominated and star bus dominated galaxies. So I can, here I compare the SED of an AGN and star bus. So for an AGN, AGN typically are able to heat the dust to higher temperatures. So we have this excess mid-infrared emission. This, this green line is the Spitzer IRS spectrum. And this is compared to a galaxy that is classified as starburst, where we see that the mid-infrared emission is much fainter than we have for the AGN. So basically, in the mid-infrared, we are able to detect this excess mid-infrared emission that tells us the AGN contribution. Another point that we find with the galaxies is that they don't have X-ray emission or hard X-ray emission, and they do not have the detection or the neon fire. So basically, we have some galaxies that are optical and mid-infrared AGN-dominated systems that are here, that are compact sources, as expected for an AGN, but with a high excess mid-infrared emission. But then we have like other half of the nuclei that we have in the sample that are extremely compact with sizes similar to the optical AGNs, but without this infrared or mid-infrared excess in the system. So how to explain this, if there's an AGN there, and one possibility is that even the mid-infrared is absorbed. And this is based on some models that when you have column densities higher than 10 to the 25 centimeter minus two, even the mid-infrared emission between, well, this less than 10 micron is completely absorbed. And we did some tests to investigate this. So we measure the silicate absorption, that is this feature at 9.7 micron, with the size that we measure in the continuum. And what we find, there is no clear correlation between the silicate absorption measured in these systems and the size of the continuum. So what this seems is that the mid-infrared emission that we see in these galaxies, that are this compact, is not produced by the part or the, let's say, the region of the galaxy that is producing most of the galaxy. And this is because this emission is likely absorbed by extremely high column densities. Now I will briefly describe how to further investigate this and some future or also already ongoing work we are doing. So we have some follow-up observations, extremely high resolution, 30 milliseconds, that for ULIRGs correspond to 60 parsecs. We have these observations for three ULIRGs, and in particular, I show here one example. So this is classified H2 galaxy based on the optical BPT diagram. Also based on the mid-infrared, we find an AGN contribution that is less than 50%. So basically in the mid-infrared SED, we are not able to see any warm dust produced by the AGN. However, based on the ALMA continuum, we find that the continuum size is dominated by a source with a size, with a radius less than, or an unresolved source with a size less than 50 parsecs. So now, these are the data that we have analyzed so far. This is the almost 500 parsec resolution. And this is what we see when we go to the higher, this 30 millisecond, 60 parsec resolution. And we see that we are able to resolve the continuum emission in few structures, and we are able to resolve the CO emission. As we say again, the distribution of the CO and the continuum are again different. So this is an analysis that we have for the continuum emission. So basically we have a point source with a radius less than 9 parsecs that is contributing like 30-35% of the flux of this galaxy. Then we have an extended CMD that has a size of 50 parsecs, that is this structure that we see here. So this is the continuum emission after subtracting a point source. So this has a is a compact, is a radius of 50 parsecs, and then we also have some kind of tidal tail spiral arm that is contributing like 20% of the flux. Then for the unresolved continuum source, is possible. Well, the possibility is that this point source, compact point source, is an AGN. But then now we need to establish what is producing this flux is maybe a synchrotron contribution. So this is something that we need to investigate. But in principle, the emission that in the CMD is, should be produced by star formation, as well as the emission that we have in this extended tail. So with this information that we have now, and the sizes and fluxes, we can again calculate this star formation law, or because we also have the high resolution CO map. So we can have this kind of star formation law at 80 parsec for the CMD and for the unresolved source. So we can compare the result. So in this plot, we have these fan galaxies that are normal spiral galaxies in the local universe. We also have this sample of ULIRGs, and this is the location of the ULIRGs and the Eddington limit that is marked here. So this galaxy, when observed at 100 parsec, I think it's this point that we can see here in this diagram. But when we split this contribution into the core and the CMD, we see that the core is again above the Eddington limit, so again compatible with an AGN, but the CMD is a bit below the Eddington limit. Still, the depletion time is much shorter than found in LIRGs and local spirals. But it seems that we are able to resolve the emission from the CMD star formation and from a core that is, well, we don't know, still we don't know what is this core, but it seems that it could be an AGN extremely obscure even in the medium infrared. So we are working on this, so this is an ongoing project. And so I will end here with this, with the summary of the work we have been doing. So basically, we investigated the effects of interaction on mergers using these local ULIRGs. We measured the feedback and the outflows. We were able to detect massive molecular outflows with outflow rates similar to the star formation rate in 75% or 80% of the of local ULIRGs. But we also determined that only a small fraction, 20-25% of the gas can escape. And so these estimations are based on this, let's say, simplified model, because when we go to high resolution, we know that see that the gas is being accelerated. We also find that the conditions of the CO gas in the outflow are different. So maybe the conversion factor to go from the CO flux to this mass are different. So basically, we need more models as well as observations to establish how accurate is this equation, because this is the, if when you observe this outflow at high resolve, you don't have all the information that we have for this unit. So basically, you are limited to this simplified model. So this is an ongoing work, both on models and observation. And then another relevant result is well, to determine what is the power source of local ULIRGs. We find that the systems could be mid-infrared obscure with a compact core. That we don't know yet, but we have two possibilities. It's either star formation with the top heavy IMF, so we are able to produce these luminosities with this small amount of gas, or maybe it's because there is an AGN in the system. And then in the future, I think there is hope to solve all these questions that we have opened with this investigation. We can use high resolution ALMA, JWST, and ELT data that for sure will help to solve all these issues. So I think I can stop here. And yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Miguel, for this talk. And now, I should open the talk for questions, please raise your hand for doing a question. And we have one raised hand by Enrique Perez Montero, please.
Okay, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yep.
Perfect. Okay, very nice talk, Miguel. It's a wonderful project with a lot of valuable information. I'm very surprised for so many data. I have, in fact, two questions, if you let me. The first of them is related with the star formation rate derivation. You have commented at the beginning of your talk that the outflows velocity is compatible with the expected star formation rate. I guess this is obtained from the infrared luminosity, not from the optical. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. And it is still compatible when you take into account the AGA and the contribution that you have commented later.
Well, the problem is that what we detect is a compact core, but we don't know what is producing the luminosity from that compact core. So we propose these two options, that is either an AGN, that is the completely obscure, but it could be also this top heavy IMF star formation. So when we compare the, or we establish the, or we measure the star formation rate, it's based on the standard infrared to star formation rate relation. But if it is true that we have a top heavy IMF, maybe the star formation rate cannot be calculated with that relation. And if we have an AGN, we also need to subtract this contribution to the star formation rate we derive. So I think this is an open question, but it's actually a very interesting question that we are trying to answer with these observations.
Okay, and I have a second one, if René lets me.
Go on.
Okay, thank you. Which is related with the MUSE plots and the optical emission lines. I don't know to what extent you can use these emission lines in the optical to get the physical conditions or the chemical abundances of the shock contribution in the outflows from the ULIRGs. Is that possible? In addition, you have enough spectral resolution to the blend different kinematical components, or you need another thing deeper to get this information from the outflows in the optical?
Yes, so well, in this talk, I mainly focus on the ALMA data, but we have the analysis of the MUSE data, some papers by Michele Perna, and some other submitted papers also by Michele. And in that paper, we are able to resolve, to isolate, let's say, the outflow emission in the oxygen three and the nitrogen two lines in the optical. And also because these outflows are not in general in the disk of the systems, then they are not that affected by extinctions. So in principle, the emission in the optical that we see of the outflows can measure can be used to measure the abundances in that gas.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Enrique. We have another question by Isabel. Go on.
Hello, very, very nice talk. Thank you very much, Miguel. It's been a pleasure to hear you. In fact, I have two questions. First one is concerning the effect that you've told about some galaxies were not ULIRGs but LIRGs, and you have at least one example of an isolated spiral. So my question was in the sense of knowing whether you have enough numbers, big numbers, to know it, or to have an idea of any trend with respect to the merger state.
Yeah, well, I have talked here mainly about the ULIRG sample that we have, these 25, that in principle we try to sample all, well, the different merger phases and the AGN and star formation. So this is more or less covered. Then for the lower luminosity, we have another sample of LIRGs. I think there are 20 or around 20, 25 that I have not discussed here. This is part of the work of my PhD student, Maria Sanchez. And basically the LIRGs are quite heterogeneous group. So if I go to this, let me go this introduction. Is this one? So basically, ELIRGs, as I said, is a luminosity threshold. So we can have massive galaxies that are maybe isolated, but they are still in almost close to the main sequence for that luminosity and star formation rate. But we also have lower mass galaxies that are quite away from the main sequence. So these are starbursts. So basically, these galaxies tend to be interacting systems, while galaxies closer to the main sequence are typically isolated spirals, or maybe in some cases, like minor mergers. The particular case that I showed is an isolated spiral. I think it's a quite particular case because this is classified as a compact obscure nucleus. There are very few objects like this in the local universe. And possibly this is this ISO 320 galaxy. Yes, it's a galaxy that has a strong bar in the system. Actually, has this strong bar and also has a 90 degree secondary bar, as can be seen here. So this system with this particular geometry is producing this possibly this interaction, the potential and this resonance effect is producing an extreme inflow, and that's the reason that we can use this galaxy with this extreme concentration of molecular gas in the center as an analog to the what we see in ULIRGs. But it's true that LIRGs are a completely heterogeneous group, so we need to be careful when we consider these galaxies to trace the evolution of mergers.
Could you please trace in that image once you are there of the extent and position approximate at least of the outflow in that galaxy, please?
So this is the
Okay. No, but I was talking about the big scale, so just to know where is in the other.
It's in this more or less in this direction.
And that region as well. Okay, thank you. So the other question, if you go to the plot where you were showing the spectral energy distributions of one galaxy on top with no AGN and on the bottom with AGN, or the contrary, I don't remember.
This one, exactly.
So in the top, you're showing a red point, which is under the prediction. So what's the meaning of that? Why is that? I mean,
in this case, there is a factor of four difference. And possibly this is because we are not properly modeling the infrared SED. Because here in the SED, we have a contribution from one dust that we should take into account. So this is a simplified model with a single temperature.
So it works good for the other one, but not for that one. Okay. So just a clarification. So my question was, have you checked whether you have X-ray data to see if your objects that you are saying that are expected to be very, very obscured, in fact, correspond to what in X-rays is expected to be a compton thick object? Because you're talking about absorptions in nitrogen of greater than 10 to the 25. So that's compton thick. So you should find traces in X-rays, right?
Yes. So, but basically the problem we have with these obscure AGNs is that they do not have hard X-ray detection. Maybe in the future, where more sensitive Athena, for example, could detect the X-ray emission. Today, they are not detected in hard X-rays, and they are neither detected in the mid-infrared. So basically, the AGN in ULIRGs that you detect in the
what's the instrument you refer to for the X-ray, for the hard X-rays?
I think this is the SWIFT. Sky survey.
Okay, so it may be a sensitivity question. Okay.
Yes.
Good. Thank you. Thank you very much. Very good talk. Miguel.
Thank you.
Thank you, Isabel. Okay, we have another question by Rosa. Please go.
Hello. Thank you very much for the talk. It's very beautiful work and very, very nice talk. It's only a comment, more than a question. It is related with the position of the Euler or LIRs in the main, about the main sequence. I think that the, we have to also to take into account that the main lead, the, when you build the main sequence, it is based in the H alpha or the more recent star formation that is spurring the galaxy. And that's more or less correlated with the phase of the merger. So that means that could be object for which the star formation, the recent star formation could be lower, but in previous phase, you estimate, for example, the star formation rate in the last few hundred million years, the star formation was higher. So that, and this is correlated with the merger phase. Does you want to add something?
Yeah, so this is a work we try to do to determine the star formation histories of a sample of LIRGs. This paper here in 2015. So for this, we have this sample of LIRGs, and we try to determine the star formation history in several stellar age beams. So if I remember well, we find that for the, we have this beam here, this 100 megagias to 1 gigagia, that it seems to be, so these galaxies had a lower star formation rate at this time. And this increase of the star formation rate happens for all of them in the last 10 to, I think, 50 mega years. So it's true that maybe there is, well, of course, there is a variation in the star formation rate, is as we saw in the, based on the numerical simulation. But yeah, I mean, it's important to have into account this this evolution of the star formation rate, and always be aware that what we measure is limited also in the time resolution.
Yeah, well, the idea that I was trying to express before is that it could be that the Euler or the LIRs, it is in a more advanced phase of the merger. And in that case, when you measure the star formation rate between 1 and 10 million years, it is low, but they are still, using in fact the star formation history when you use the previous phase, the star formation was higher. It's still higher compared with the other galaxy. And also it depends because you are using also spatial result property, that the position where it is happened, the maximum and the time scale is occurring in different position according with the merger phase, because mm-hmm. the merger can be progressed from the inside, from outside to inside.
Yes, I think this is a very interesting point. And for example, for ULIRGs, all of them are very compact. 100 parsecs is where we have the star formation. But even from here, actually the red is H alpha, so we see that we have LIRGs with very extended. So this is an interacting system, an early stage. So we see the star formation that in this phase is more extended than we go to a more advanced phase, that where all the star formation occurs in this small region. So it's true that there is an evidence or this trend in the. Of the variation in the position of the star formation depending on the phase of interaction.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Rosa. We have another question. Borja, go on.
Hi, thank you for such a nice talk. I was just wondering about the CO factor. As you propose that it could be an scenario of molecule destruction, so therefore we should expect a change in the chemical abundances, and therefore the CO factor may change also spatially due to that change in chemical abundances due to the metallicity CO factor relation, no?
Mm-hmm. Yes, indeed. This is a quite open question in this field. What conversion factor we have to use to go from the flux of these lines to an outflow or to a mass outflow. But the problem is that it's quite difficult to determine what is the true conversion factor, because we need to know the physical conditions of the gas. And as you said, not only the density and temperature, but also the abundance, the metallicity of the gas, because there is this dependence on this factor. So I think the standard factor that is used today to convert the outflow, the CO outflow emission to outflow mass, molecular mass, is the factor that is used for ULIRGs, that is like 5 times lower than the factor of the Milky Way. This is what is done today. But it's true that is the major source of uncertainty on all these estimates of the outflow rate and actually the impact of these outflows.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Borja. Any other question for Miguel? Okay, seeing none. Thank you very much again, Miguel, for this wonderful talk.
Thank you.
And hope you will enjoy the stage here at the IAA. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. Yes.
Thank you, Miguel.